Welcome to Unlimited Possibilities. I'm your host, George Bien, and I have a very powerful show for you today. I have as my guest Dr. Mikael Menos, and the show is about accelerated human evolution. Dr. Menos, it's a pleasure.
It's always a pleasure talking to you, George.
Well, great. So we're going to have a chance to really explore this issue. Accelerated human evolution.
We'll have a chance to just look at the very tip of the iceberg.
Really?
Because there's so many aspects to it, so many implications,
So
many areas that it can be looked at. It's really astonishing to me, and it's been astonishing me for about 20 years now. When I first came across these ideas, I was amazed that these ideas were not on the front page of the New York Times.
You mean regularly? Because I mean, I studied evolution, of course, as a child in school. I mean, are things different now? I mean, do we look at evolution differently?
I think, are in the process of starting to look at evolution differently. Of course, it's taken us a couple of centuries to get oriented to the idea. One really funny story, by the way, in the history of the ideas of evolution has to do with this guy, Richard Chambers. He wrote a book called Vestiges of Natural Creation 15 years before Darwin's book came out on the Origin of the Species. And at the time that he wrote that book, the scientists scoffed at him, ridiculed him, but the masses, the people, intuitively sensed that there was something very correct in what he was talking about. The book became a bestseller. Now, he published the book himself. He was a publisher, became a very successful publisher. Mm-hmm. He wrote the book anonymously because he was embarrassed, but whatever states of mind led him to be unwilling to divulge his identity. Were just stupendous. And actually, at one point, he was sitting for, I think they called it Provost of Edinburgh, a political position. And he was challenged and told that if he wanted to continue going for that political position, he would have to stand up to this this debate going on as to whether or not he was the author of this book. And he chose to retire. But this same guy wrote some very apparently interesting things on spirituality, which to this day his descendants are still keeping in a locked file cabinet. Anyway, I'm going a little bit on a tangent, but see, this is just my point. There's so many tangents in this this area.
So, did it parallel the Darwinian theory, or did Darwin take it from him, or was it different? Or
Darwin's theory had its antecedents. Chambers' theory was not very clearly articulated in the way that Darwin's was, but it did allow for the idea of evolution as something that would be within a divine plan, which is quite different than the Darwinian position, and actually was followed up, not necessarily because Teilhard de Chardin had read, I don't know whether or not he had read Chambers' work, but Teilhard de Chardin continued this train of thinking that one could reconcile the idea of evolution with the idea of a divine plan, with the idea of spiritual evolution and growth and development. And actually what's fascinating in the history of that is that the Church Fathers tried so hard to stop his ideas. They even banished him to Africa at one point.
Is that a fact?
They wanted to slow down his writing on this. And ironically, though, in Africa, he hooked up with some other people who were looking at, you know, paleontology and whatnot. And he ended up inspiring Wallace, who was one of the big biologists or evolutionists at that time. So, and then Teilhard de Chardin's line of thinking actually parallels a very modern one of a Hindu Kashmiri philosopher yogi by the name of Pandit Gopi Krishna.
You know, this is like wild stuff. I'm listening to this stuff. Now, how has, let's say, our look at evolution today, let's say modern science, how does that differ, or is it similar to the way it's been, let's say, 20, 30, 40 years ago, 100 years ago?
How is it different or the same? Well, specifically looking at the idea of the evolution of the brain, let's just focus on that, because this has so many realms and dimensions. But if you look at evolution of the brain, when Gopi Krishna had books were first coming out in the 60s, the idea that the brain is continuing to evolve, that brain cells are capable of regeneration, that old age doesn't necessarily lead to senility and degeneration, I mean, at those in those times, it just wasn't admitted, the idea of continuing brain evolution. And things have shifted just in the last 20, 30 years on that account.
Now, you're saying that the brain evolves also. And I would imagine it wouldn't in an enriched environment. But what about the brain cells themselves?
These are the more recent discoveries that the brain cells themselves are capable of growing bigger. The dendritic connections are longer, wider, more synaptic connections. In Einstein's brain recently, or I don't know how recently, but they found, you know, an increase in the number of glial cells in the higher centers of the brain, the cortex.
And which would mean that?
These glial cells are essentially the glue of that whole system, in that they bring nourishment to the neurons, say, in the cerebral cortex.
Now, I've read where it's been said that they're saying the reason Einstein thought the thoughts he did was because of the nature of his brain. Then I read the reason that the nature of his brain was such was because of the thoughts he thought.
Well, that's a very, very interesting idea. Okay. Of course, more and more now people are realizing that we cannot make a clear separation between our thoughts and what's going on biologically. So that then has tremendous implications. For example, the idea that morality is important in accelerating brain evolution, that actually thinking kind, loving, compassionate thoughts, which have been the teachings of all the founders of all major faiths, are actually helping to accelerate this.
Well, I'm going to think some nice thoughts every day.
Well, that's right. It'll be helpful to you and your progeny for you to do that.
So you're saying kindness to our fellow human beings, it is kind of a thing, kindness to the animals, and kindness to the planet itself,
yes,
raising our consciousness and love and to the rainforests and everything else that we seem to be destroying. But if we just reach out to these things with kindness and love, our brain cells, and will they regenerate actually, or will they just...
Well, all of the details of this, it's going to take us centuries to understand more of the details of this. But the basic central views have been around for thousands and thousands of years. And actually, the teachings of the founders of all faiths, the purpose of those teachings is to keep us on the path to remove obstructions to evolution and keep us on the path where we are not getting in the way of our own evolution. And of course, every civilization that failed to heed some of these basic central teachings, you know, not being overly indulgent, not allowing greed to predominate and whatnot, any civilization that started departing from that found its end. So there is this process in nature that's guarding us and at times meets the end of a civilization. And for our civilization today, and here's where the serious note comes in, we can already see clear signs that we're following the same course that all the other civilizations did before their downfall and
now,
transformation.
Of course, there are streams of consciousness, and there are thoughts and there are theories that a human being is basically evil, greed-driven, and of course there are exceptions. But what would you say about that? The basic core of a human being.
The basic core of a human being. The basic core of a human being is essentially divine.
Okay.
Beyond time and space. And this is such a wonderful message that there is the spark of the divine in not only in every human being, but in everything, in organic and inorganic nature both. And that one speck of this actually radiates through the central nervous system and the brain, which is the link to between the spiritual and material worlds. Of course, the spiritual and material worlds, the material world is only one aspect of the dimension of being. And as one ascends on the evolutionary scale, one becomes aware of more and more vast levels of being.
So you think as a population, on this planet at least, we are evolving consciously? Because it seems to be more destruction now than ever. There seem to be more use of drugs. There's more killings, it seems. So, I mean, are we evolving?
Well, the message of this guy, who was a really neat guy, Gopi Krishna, he died about 10 years ago, but his message, which he articulated the message of the earlier prophets and sages in language for today, is that the evolutionary mechanism is at work. The evolutionary mechanism is always taking place, constantly, but what we need to look at is the extent to which we're putting obstacles in its place. We are all constantly evolving at a very slow pace. Now, we can accelerate that, or we can put obstacles there, and things like greed, things like one person having $20 billion and another person having nothing to eat and their child dying because of having nothing to eat is counter-evolutionary.
So let's say the world, I mean, we know this whole economy of this world is controlled by maybe 500, maybe 1,000 families. I mean, they control the systems. They control the governments. They control what the president does. I mean, on and on. They control how much money people make in general. So these people perhaps are greed-driven. They're money-driven. So are they stifling the evolutionary process for themselves or for everybody else? How does that work?
Well, that's, you ask such wonderful questions. So inspiring, so provocative. And, well, now, I am convinced, because ever since I've been a child, I have believed in the essential goodness of all beings. And that question of evil, by the way, of course, in different ways, the environment teaches us evil things, or to behave in ways that someone else ends up judging as evil. As you had once pointed out in one of the hypnosis seminars I took with you, that even a person who kills someone at some point in their development, their unconscious perceived that as a good thing. But to try not to sidetrack again, I believe that those, what is, did you say 10,000 people?
Well, let's 1,000 say 1,500, 1,000, whatever
they
it is.
They are not aware, I don't believe that they are aware of the extent to which their actions or non-actions are interfering with their own evolution.
So they're the blinders
and
on.
And with the evolution of the entire race as well, of course. And the thing is that we've taken a leap in evolution as a result of technology, which has, technology has served this purpose of one, the concentration of the mind has increased because concentration is one of the levers of evolution, but also in that technology has allowed to some of us some leisure time, the ability to have a fuller life, which is very important for healthy brain evolution.
Actually,
my ability to concentrate. There's so many things going on in my head at once.
Evolving so quickly.
Where was I? What was the?
We're basically talking about those families and whether they, in turn, are aware of what they're doing and whether they really care.
That we have taken this leap. Whenever a leap is taken, it's extremely important that the environment be conducive to a healthy growth.
Okay.
Because with the leap, with the acceleration in the central nervous system and the brain, the sensitivity grows. And this explains...
Okay, the sensitivity grows.
Exactly. This explains the rise of mental illness or difficulties in living in our day, and many, many other phenomena can be understood. And actually, by this very biological mechanism, there is an overlap in several phenomena: mystical experiences, genius, mediumistic phenomena, psychic phenomena, and what has been called insanity or mental illness as well. There is a similar biological process going on through the whole central nervous system, and it includes, by the way, the reproductive, what ordinarily functions in a reproductive way, and the other end, the brain, and what determines whether or not you have someone who's well-adjusted, in their full potential, perhaps a genius in some sphere, or someone who ends up in a state hospital on Ward's Island. It's going to be depend on a number of factors, including, of course, the environment. For healthy, beautiful flowers to grow, it's important that weeds be removed, that the soil be as rich as possible. All the conditions for healthy living apply on the material plane, the mental plane, the spiritual plane. There are laws governing all of these planes, and this is what I think the modern mind is becoming more and more open to.
So you're saying enriched environment, basically. Now, if the let me, maybe, I don't know, hopefully I'm on the right track here. When you said the difference between somebody who'll become mentally ill, perhaps, versus somebody who's a genius, would the environment have a lot to do with that? Or is there a predisposition? Or is it both?
Of course it's both.
Okay, it's both.
Yes.
But there could be an environment.
And an interaction as well.
So let's say you get somebody who perhaps is less than adequate mentally at the moment, or perhaps they're living in their fantasy world, whatever it may be. If you put them in a, perhaps a very highly enriched environment, or you have somebody, let's say of yourself, because of course you're a licensed psychologist, work with this kind of an individual, and you meet them at their model of reality, could you help then lead them to a reality that perhaps is governed within our physical construct?
Well, the beautiful thing in this is that healthy evolution is always possible, no matter how bad the situation looks to begin mm-hmm. with. But what's important in this is understanding the factors involved. What is a healthy evolution? What factors get in the way? Which ones are interfering? So yes, the answer is yes, but conditional. And the conditional part will probably take centuries to understand.
Now, what about somebody whose brain has been physically damaged? Now, previously it's been at least taught or understood or believed that if one side of the brain, whatever, that side, the other side will be paralyzed in a person, and that's it, that part is damaged. Now it's been learned that other brain parts will take over the functions.
Mm-hmm.
Now, does that mean that if a brain is damaged, it can regenerate itself? Is that possible, and to what extent?
Well, they're finding now that, that yes, regeneration is possible.
Okay.
To what extent? I believe the possibilities are infinite.
Okay.
I love being on your show. I love the title of your show because these ideas, mm-hmm. which have been very dear to my heart, and I've been working very hard to have my intellect catch up mm-hmm. with different aspects of knowledge to integrate with this whole idea of accelerating human evolution for about the last 20 years now. But I've always intuitively felt that the possibilities are endless. And what would it take but billions of hours of human individuals focusing on this as a project?
Okay, now you're saying focusing on a project, you mean as far as a study, or perhaps just sitting there within a level of deep internal meditation
mm-hmm.
and saying, let this happen,
mm-hmm.
or both?
Both
I
and combined. Both
combined.
And combined. However the person is, it's for each person to look within themselves and ascertain how are they moved by these ideas. How can their lives be uplifted or perhaps improved as a result? And by the way, just thinking about these ideas helps accelerate the evolutionary process, helps to activate the center in the brain that awakens to activity, helps to increase the level of fuel supplying this part of the brain. So just thinking about these ideas is helpful. But perhaps if one would think of quickly now, in the next 10 years, what can be done to influence world conditions, the ideal would probably be a combination, as far as who would work on this project, the ideal would be a combination of a sage and scientist, perhaps someone who now already knows a lot about the tools out there for brain research, for physiological research. And the irony, the sadness now is that many of these very good people, they're good people in every walk of life, many of these scientists are simply not aware of the wealth of information in many, many religious scriptures, in many of the writings of the mystics of all times, of geniuses of all times. There's an overlap in the things that they experienced. And so by combining the internal,
both
the look
internal,
within, and outer study, that would be the best way for us to take a huge, to be up to the huge leap that has been happening.
Okay, let's just go back with this evolutionary and this accelerated evolutionary aspect. And you, we were focusing pretty much on the brain in a lot of, a good part of this. Now, as far as outside influences on the brain, like you had mentioned, I know we were talking, you were talking about Megabrain, Michael Hutchinson. Now, basically using these kind of tools, these machines and things like that, how effective are they as far as stimulating brain cells?
Well, I haven't tried one myself.
Okay.
I'm curious, too. I understand there's some kind of a parlor now in Manhattan where you can do that.
Because I'm into light and sound.
Yeah.
And that I find effective.
Yeah. Well, I had a little brief discussion about it in the bookstore where I bought that book not so long ago where I was expressing some skepticism. You know, technology is always to help us and not to take over and become the prime target of our activities. But the guy who owns the bookstore said something to me like at the cash register, well, you know, you can't expect these machines to do for someone in 20 minutes what perhaps some people have taken 20 years to work towards by using some of the disciplines that are common to all spiritual esoteric type traditions. I said, no, and neither can you expect it to do what has actually taken 20,000, 20 million, whatever, years in our long evolution. I think that, so I actually can't fully address that question because I haven't finished Michael Hutchinson's book yet, number one. But I think that it can be, just like hypnosis can be helpful in accessing certain
realms. So it can accelerate, probably.
It can probably open us up to the possibilities, but I find it probably doubtful that that in and of itself alone would create a genius or a prophet of the stature of those who are undeniable. We now look back through all time. There are certain people who stand out as individuals who contributed something to the race in the very long term. And I feel that it's doubtful that these actual tools will lead to the development of that kind of individual. But if it can help open someone's mind to a different way of being, and also if perhaps these tools can help us investigate
I'm just going to throw my goggles away.
No, well, they do. Uh-huh. They do appear to lead to very interesting altered states of consciousness. Mm-hmm. But lots of other things do also. People were looking at drugs at one point.
Right.
But did that lead to actually enlightenment?
Some of them claim they did.
But where are they now?
Well, still having problems. Well, let me ask you this. You're right.
God bless them all.
You're right. God bless them all. Now, you're talking about altered states of consciousness. Now, obviously, in an altered state of consciousness, we can retain, we can learn, we can accelerate, usually, okay, our brain activity?
Yeah.
Is that true? I mean, do you believe that's true, an altered state?
Well, an altered state of consciousness is always the result of a change at the organic level.
Okay.
They're inseparable.
So therefore, if we were in that state, we probably could access information much more quickly and process it much more quickly?
Absolutely. Well, this has been known through all time. And this is the secret underlying all esoteric traditions.
Mm-hmm.
Kundalini, that's the Indian term for this evolutionary mechanism, for example, was known as the goddess of speech.
Oh, okay.
That when somebody truly activated this process within themselves, they were able to express themselves to all those around them in a way that it was clear that they were in some way enlightened or had something worth communicating. Now, if we look at mind, and it's very interesting to look at mind and how infinite and vast that is, and how limited most of our brains are in tapping into these unlimited potentials.
So I'm glad you separated mind and brain, because so many people equate mind and brain as the simultaneous, and it's not true. It's the brain.
I'm glad you made that point also.
Brain and
the central nervous system is, in many traditions, considered as the holy temple through which mind or spirit or soul is able to express itself on the earthly plane. And what we're talking about is accelerating the evolution of this divine temple in a way that it's able to express more and more of the infinite possibility of mind.
Mm-hmm.
I get so excited by this topic.
Tell you, I'm going into altered state just listening to it. Let's say somebody, a viewer out there, is listening to this and saying, Dr. Menos, this is overwhelming stuff and this is fabulous. What could I do to begin, let's say, get on a track of accelerated brain evolution? What could I do? What would be the first step? Would it be to meditate? Would it be to just involve myself in a lot of the great readings?
I've read a lot in many, many different traditions.
Mm-hmm.
Since my about 16th year, and I'm now 38 or 39. I was
You're actually sharing?
I've read a lot. And this guy, Gopi Krishna, had some very clear, techniques or inspirational hints for this. Again, always in language that, perhaps language that a modern person can hear. And one of the things he said, cause I'm saying this as a prelude because it's not my words or my ideas, but through all the things I read, I always found his advice the most sound, which was that first, study. Look at what others who came before, who accelerated this within themselves and accessed these higher states of being, look at the accounts, and we have many accounts of what they experienced and what they had to say. And not just one, but more than one.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, if you stick to just one, the chances are you might be misled, because we're all human, and the human part accompanies us always. So prophets express these basic truths, often colored by their culture, by their own human personalities and whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
So to study and look at the accounts of others, and also, of course, whatever faith most appeals to you, whatever religion, whatever scripture most appeals to your heart, to read it, to look at it very closely and study it, and that to help you kind of stay on the path. And so that's a first step. Second step, turning inward in some way. Now concentration, whether it's concentration on a physics book or on a flute, concentration is always the lever. So concentrating and focusing, and whether we use meditation, prayer, contemplation of some kind, mm-hmm. or even pondering the questions of life, who am I? What is my goal? How can I help others? So this kind of contemplative turning inward of the mm-hmm. attention of the mind is helpful. And third of all, of course, very, very important, is to increase in nobility, to work on perfecting moral qualities within oneself, to be more loving, to be less selfish, to be more compassionate, more charitable. All of these beautiful moral qualities that all founders have spoken about are actually guiding you on the path, accelerating evolution, actually removing blockages, purifying this energy that's traveling through your body is being purified by that. And do I have time to say one more thing?
One more thing.
Okay, purifying the body, the mind, and the morals. Uh-huh. You know, of course, you can't, like, be really impure at a physical level. And what that means, each person has to judge for themselves and expect to achieve a higher state of consciousness.
Wow. Whew. Dr. Menos, I'm sorry, we've run out of time. It went like this. I hope you come back for another show, because I think we just, like you said, we just touched the tip of this iceberg.
I would love to come for another show.
Wonderful stuff. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me.
Whew. Dr. Mikhail Menos, my head is still spinning from all this information. And hopefully it's basically evolving even more because of this information. And as she said, get yourself involved in some wonderful readings. Get yourself involved with some wonderful people who are on a similar path. And above all, turn inward. Think good thoughts, because within these good thoughts, you're able to elevate the consciousness within yourself and help also elevate the consciousness on this planet. After all, we know the planet is in dire need right now for people who are really on the same path of spiritual fulfillment, spiritual growth, and truly on a path of enlightenment. So it's up to you. And we know how strong the single individual can be when he or she ignites the flame in others. Until next time, this is George Bien.